Hello, guys. You hear me? Thank you. Any questions before we start? Okay, we still have 1 minute. Any questions? Okay, I guess we can start. First let's look at where we are now. So can you guys see a teaching plan? PDF file, teaching plan. Hello? Can you guys hear me? Okay, so thank you. So right now we are here, right? We are here. So basically we are in very good shape in terms of a schedule. We finished the system call, then our homework one has been due. We finished the major issue related to the file system. Okay. So from our assessment, right? So basically we have 3 labs finished. Okay. So I think a tutor already grade 2 labs and release the grade. So make sure if you are not, you have issues about the grading, please contact the tutor. Okay, actually tutor, our first tutor, Ke Chen has done excellent work to finish the grading based on our schedule. Our assignment one, you can see here, we already, our assignment one, right? Actually already due last weekend. Basically, we allow the late submission. So tutor will start to do the grading by this weekend. Then we should have the grade by next week. I will discuss that once we finish the grading and also release the marking scheme. Okay. Yeah, so this is our current situation, okay, basically. Yeah, so in terms of our assessment, I hope everyone realize right now, okay, our assessment. Okay, can you guys see the assessment here? Hello? Can you guys see assessment? Okay, so we have around four labs. Actually, maybe this year we have five, okay. Basically here, if we have five, then it will share the 5%, total 5% among these 110. Okay, then each lab is 1%, okay, basically, okay. So our first assignment has been finished, okay. Then we will have assignment two and the project will be released. Okay, actually, if you go to the Blackboard, you can see that assignment two and the project have been released. So basically, this is kind of 10%, 10%, 15%. Okay, so we already have, here we have like, 3%, around 3%, okay? You can see this is around like 1/4, right? Yeah, so I know this online teaching is kind of, somehow you stay at home, then it's a little bit hard to keep with your schedule, right? So, but make sure you look at the assessment as well. So make sure you know the progress and finish the homework, okay? Based on the timeline. So if you have any questions related to the grading, please contact the tutor. Then solve the issue. Okay, if you have some issue you cannot solve, then basically you can come to me, you can send me email. Okay, after you check with the tutor, but still cannot solve those issues. Okay, so for the first two labs, we will not give you the marking scheme because they are very simple, okay? And starting from assignment, each assignment we will release a marking scheme, so we will let you know so why you get a certain points, right? Or deducts, why some points are deducted. Okay, so let me go back to our major topics we have finished in the last 2 weeks, basically related to the file system implementation, okay? So simply speaking, we finished two examples, right? So the first one is iNode. Basically, we spend a lot of time for this example. Okay, of course, this is an example, but generally speaking, we can extend this to have more indirect pointer. Okay, or multiple level. Here we only have single level. So maybe you have a double indirect, triple indirect and so on. But basically the idea you can see clearly from here, you can see that if we have this kind of design for this iNode, then we have three integer here, right? So for the direct pointer, we have two, then we have one indirect pointer. Then how can we organize our file size and file space? So generally speaking, we talk about disk are divided into several parts, but mainly we have iNode region and the data region. So our data will be stored into data region based on data block. So those information will be stored into our iNode. Okay, then iNode number will be used to find the corresponding iNode. Then from iNode, then we can find all information. So this is a one design. From this example, you can see this is one design, right? Okay. Then we also talk about some equation, some simple equation that from those equation, basically we can find out the corresponding data block number, right? Record into the, either is inside inode or inside the data block. Then from there, then we can find our data. Yeah. So another very important issue we talk about is how to find the inode. So basically we talk about this example, right? This is the second example we talk about. Of course, this also can be generalized to other design, but the idea is that here directory file is used to organize all files together. Okay, directory file is a special file. Then because directory file is a special file, then it also has inode. So through this inode, we can find the data stored in this directory file. The data stored in directory file is different from other file, other regular file. This is special file. It will store the mapping of the files under this directory. File name and inode number. Okay. Then we start from the root, then recursively, then we can find the corresponding inode for a particular file under a particular directory. Okay, in this way, then we obtain the inode number. Then after we obtain inode number, then we can follow what we have here. They follow this design. So this design can be different from different system. We may have different item entries here inside our data structure. But generally speaking, we should have some space. Okay, this is mapping, right? Then find our data corresponding, then we finish. Okay. So that's the whole story we discussed. Then you will find from the homework, basically, that's exactly what we discussed, okay? So let me move back to look at assignment two. So can you guys see assignment two? Hello? Okay, thank you. Okay, see, you can see that this is an example exactly we discussed in the lecture, and also the tutor will discuss this again, okay? Of course, in principle, they are the same, but the specific number are different. But when you go through those examples, hopefully you can understand the inode and also the directory file, okay? So this will deal March 13, okay? So you have 3 weeks to do it. So this is a very simple assignment, okay? If you cannot finish this one, I'm sorry, guys, okay? Maybe you should withdraw from this this course, okay? So if you cannot finish, okay? Yeah, because I mean, it's very difficult. If you cannot finish that, this homework is difficult, okay? So project, okay? Project is pretty much related to what we discussed, okay? After we finish the paper assignment, then please go to look at this a project, which is a program assignment. We have data structure related to the related to hard disk, super block, inode, data block, okay? Then the assignment is related to implement two functions. Here we can call it a system call, but basically it's user level. So we ask you to implement the open, we ask you to implement the read. Basically we already have a disk file. We already read some file and directory and the files into it, then we ask you to read from it. Okay, then this object, if you want to really understand it, then please go to the lab. We have very good labs to help you to understand the superblock, to help you understand inode from the program perspective. Right? So after that, I think it's not very difficult for you to implement this project. So the due date you can see is April 10th. Okay. So why April 10th? Because you can see that our reading week is April 10th, right? That April 3rd to April 9th. So basically, I hope everyone can utilize that reading week to really do something, right? So then after that, maybe you are ready for the final exam, okay, to prepare the final, right? Okay, so I think that's pretty much review, right? To serve as a review. Okay, any question at this moment? Looks like everything is okay, right? Okay, let me continue, okay? Yeah, so I think this slide we stopped last time. So then one major issue related to the data block and inode, how to find those free inode and free inode, a free data block and a free inode. The reason is that whenever we want to create a new file, which means we need to allocate a new inode, then we should find out the free inode. Of course, similarly, if we want to allocate the data for a file, then we should find the free data block. So this is why we want to have that two bitmap. Remember our disk layout, we have after super block, then we have a data block bitmap and also inode bitmap. Then utilize two simple bitmap, then basically we can have very simple algorithm. For example, first free algorithm, right? Just a linear scan of bitmap, find the first free inode or first free data blocks, then basically we can utilize that, okay? So next, let's look at some utilize this open read-write to look at the whole process when we operate files. Okay, first let's look at open, okay? So here, when we have this open, this system call, then inside the kernel, actually what we should do. So first we should traverse the path name, okay? Then locate the desired inode, okay? So this is basically what we should do. Basically we should locate the desired inode, right, from the open. Then how to do that? As we mentioned last time, we began at the root of the file system, root directory. Root directory actually is a file, right? So this root inode number should be null by default in the beginning, okay? So for example, in most Unix file system, root number is 2. Okay, of course, this is a decide by us. So in our assignment, our number is start from 0. So it's just use a 0. Okay, then we start from inode number 2. Then because this number 2 is a re-index for inside our inode region, then after we translate this inode number, then we go to the data block correspondingly, then we can get the content. Then after we get this inode number, then get the inode, corresponding inode, then inside, remember the mapping, right? So look inside, find the pointers related to our data block, okay? So here, this data block is used to store the content of the root directory. Root directory is a special file. All directory files are special file, right? As we mentioned, directory file is used to store the mapping between file name and inode number. So then from those entry, we should find one for foo. Okay, this entry relate to foo and corresponding inode number. If we could not find, that means, sorry, okay, in this file system, we don't have such a path. Okay, then we return error. Otherwise, we continue, say, oh, we find it, then recursively until we reach to bar, right? Until we reach to bar, which means after we find the inode number for the foo, then we use inode number of the foo, then find the corresponding inode for foo in inode region, then read this inode into the memory. Then from there, then we have the data mapping area, direct pointer, indirect pointer, and so on. Then from there, we find the content related to the foo. Okay, then from the content over there, then we try to find the bar. Okay, if we find the bar, then basically we return the inode number, then we finish. Okay, of course, during this whole process, we should check the file permission. Then we already talked about if file permission is okay, then we allocate a file descriptor for this process and return file descriptor to user, right? So here, of course, we are talking about the system call, but in your homework, we simplify this. Basically, you only need to return this inode number, should be okay. Yeah. So I think, I got some questions, okay. So I will talk about that later. Okay, so then let's look at read. Okay, after we find the file descriptor, then So basically, from the system call perspective, after we have a file descriptor, then we can utilize the file descriptor to read. So then actually through this file descriptor, then we can find the corresponding inode. Then from inode, we can find the location, corresponding data block. Then we can read the content. Then after we read, we will update the inode with a new access time, last access time, okay? Yeah, of course, if, this is our, we read something, then we should keep our file offset, those information. For example, in SFT, we record those information, then we can update those information, okay? Then when file is closed, then we should clear our file descriptor table, deallocate those things, then basically we finish, okay? So because we close this, then other part relate to SFT and so on. If we have them a release, but the inode will be managed by the kernel. Okay, so this is for the, let's look at the access path. When we read a file from disk, so here, let's start from open. Then we read three blocks from this foo and bar, okay? Basically, our path is start from root. Then we go to the foo. Then we go to the bar, Okay, then you can see here, this column, the first column here, basically show our system call, open, read, read. So we have three read. Basically we read three data blocks from data block 0, 1, 2 in this case, okay? Then this will maybe involve data bitmap and annual bitmap. Okay, this is our second column. Our third column related to the inode. Okay, all inode involved. We have root inode, full inode, bar inode. Our fourth column related to our data. You can see this is our data block, root data block, full data block, bar data block 0, 1, 2. Okay, so this is the table, row and column. So when we open bar, as we mentioned before, if we want to open this path, starting from root, then go to full, then go to bar, we should read root inode first. Okay, this is given by default. Okay, after we get root inode, then we should go to root data blocks. Right, because we want to match full under this directory, under root directory. Then root is a directory file, is used to store the mapping between file name and inode number under this directory, okay? So if we have this path, we should find one entry for full. Then we go to read the root directory file, which is the record inside the root inode. Okay, which data block we should read. So after we find the corresponding inode number for full, then we read full inode. Okay, then similarly, we should read full data because full also is a directory file. So under inside this file, then we should have one mapping for bar. Okay, so we read this one. Then finally, we get the bars inode here, right? Okay. So this part is clear. Basically, this is how open works, right? So in your homework, in your project, then you should implement this part. Give it a path. Then you start from root directory, then read the inode number, follow the data structure, then match each one, then find the full, then find the corresponding inode number, then use that inode number, then go to the second inode for a full, then read the content of the full, then find the match for bar, then finally return the inode number, you finish. Okay, so first part. Okay, any questions for this part? Hello guys, can you hear me? Hello, can you hear me? Okay, let's just try. Yeah. Sometimes I'm kind of in doubt whether or not I have some student who are listening to me. Okay, then we read, right? After we have a inode, we can read. Okay, when we read, basically this part open only return our inode, right? When we read, basically we need to go through, go inside of our inode, then find the corresponding data block. Inside inode, we have data block for this first 4 kilobytes, for example, data 0, right? Then after we know this data block number, then we read our data block, okay? Then you can see here, we have write, okay? So why we need write for bars inode? So here you can see that maybe you didn't notice here. So update, after we read the block of a file, we will update inode with a new last access time. So basically, every time when we read a block, then we should update the access time, last access time. So basically, this is why we need to update the corresponding inode with this information, last access time. Okay. Then we read the second one, right? First, we need to know the location, then read the data block correspondingly, then update the access time. Right? This is the last access time. Right, okay. So basically, this is the last access time. We update this information inside inode, okay? Then continuously, we can read the third block and so on. So this part. Any questions for this part? Yeah, I think one student happy to answer that. Okay. Yeah, last extra time. Yeah. Okay, so let me continue. After I finish, I go back to answer some questions. Okay. So next, let's look at the write. Access path for write. So if we issue write to write data to file, okay, or update the file with the new content, basically, then this is more complicated. Then basically, we didn't ask you to implement this part. But if you feel the project is interesting, you want to implement this part, it's, you can play, okay? You can add a write to add a new file, add a new directory file, add a new file into the system. But anyway, so let's look at the process. Okay, so here, if we want to write, then maybe we need to allocate a new block, okay? Otherwise, if a block is overwritten, then in that case, maybe we don't need to allocate a new block. Otherwise, we need to allocate a new block. Then whenever we want to allocate a new block, then we go to the block bitmap to find a new block, right? So then basically we need to update the data block, data bitmap, if we need a new data block, okay? Whenever we do this, it generates 5 IOs, okay? First, okay, we need to, if we want to update, we have to read this data bitmap into the memory. Then we can know which one is free. Then after we find the free one, then we will write the bitmap, okay? Update this one, okay? So allocate this one, then change this to find the first free one, then make it become allocated, then write back, right? Then basically, after the bitmap, then we need to 2 more IO. Okay, one is read our inode, then another one is write inode. Okay. Of course, we need to read inode, right? So if we don't read inode, we don't know where the information relate to this location, because right now we want to put a new block, this information inside our inode. Then we have to read our inode into memory, read the corresponding information first, then we update the inode. So this is why we need to read and write. Then finally, now, because we want to write the new content, then at this moment we write the data itself into that data block. Okay, so this is a 1, 2. Here we have 2 IO, right? 1, 2, 2, then 1, right? So totally we have 5 IOs, okay? Yeah, so if we create a file, we also need to update our directory. Remember, when we create a file, we have to add this entry, the file name, and INode number into the corresponding directory. So we have a lot of IOs, basically. Let's look at this process. It become more complicated now. So correspondingly, here, the first column, you can see we have create. We first create a file, foo and bar. Then we write three blocks into this file. Okay. Then this is a bitmap. This is our inode, corresponding inode, get involved. This is our data blocks, get involved. First, let's look at create foo bar. So similarly, we should start from the root, then read the root data, then find the foo inode, right? Then read the foo data, okay? Then here, because we want to create this bar, right? So then the first thing is to allocate a free inode. So we go to inode bitmap, find it. So which means we read the inode bitmap, then write it back, okay? Then after that, we update foo's data. So could you tell me what kind of information we add here? Use this right, huh? Hello guys. We create a file. Suppose we create a new file, huh? Yeah, entry, right? So the entry relate to this bar in foo, right? So foo is a directory file. The content is file name and inode number, the mapping, right? So now we want to add this bar, a new file. Then basically we add this into foo's directory file, right? So this is why we update it here, okay? Then after that, basically, we will, because we created the inode now, then we need to read our inode into memory, then update this inode, right? So we created this inode, right? Then here we update some states. For example, the last access time or last write time and so on, because we update this file for the foo, right? Okay, we update the content, so we should update the last access time. Sorry. Okay. Then when we write correspondingly, we should read our inode. Then because suppose this is a new file, we don't have a data block, then we have to read our data block, then allocate a data free data block. Then after we get the data block, write, update our bitmap for this data block, then write the data over there, then update our access time, then correspondingly we can do this, right? For the second one, then allocate the new one, then update our data, then update metadata file and so on, right? So generally speaking, that's the whole process, right? Yeah, so I guess you may have some question here. So, yeah, I'm ready to answer some questions. Please input your question into the chat box. If you want to ask directly, also you're welcome. Okay. Yeah, I'm ready to answer some questions. So let me share the whiteboard. So please continue to post your question. Okay, if you have any questions, yeah. Last access time, inode number, full inode, and so on, right? Entry in directory. So I think, yeah, thank you guys. I mean, right. Yeah, I just deleted those questions maybe. Well, we don't have any questions. I thought we have some questions here. Read what? I mean, in read in full data. So can you clarify this question? Read always read one block each time. Right, yes. Read always read one block. Yeah. Why use write instead of read? Monkey, can you clarify your question? So what is your question? I don't understand your question actually. What do you mean? Why use write instead of read? In the write that table. Which one you are talking about? Let me share the screen. Maybe you can. We can. Which one? Which one you are talking about? Here? Here? This right? Here? Huh? Because we are talking about right, right? So we have several parts. The first part is related to the read. This is talk about when we open a file, then read it. This is talk about the system call related to the write. So this is why we talk about write. I hope I answer your question. I mean, in write, in full data. So can you directly answer which slide you are talking about, Monkey? So are you talking about this one? Huh? Because this is here. Okay. Why we want to write here? Okay. So can you tell me why? So full is what? So I think the first thing you need to know, what is the full, right? Full is a directory file, right? Full is a directory file. Full is a directory file, right? Full is a directory file. So inside directory, actually we have this entry, right? Entry for what? Entry for, generally speaking, entry for file name, and inode number. This mapping, right? Basically, because we create this new file, so we have to add this entry into corresponding directory file, which is a full. So we add this entry into full's data. I hope I answer your question. Yeah.
Then what is the use of the full inode right here?
Oh, this is right. So
I mean, so, what is the difference between these two?
Yeah, here is the data. You look at here. This is the full data, right? This one is the full inode, right? It's totally different. So directory files content is this entry mapping for all those files stored under this directory. this here, basically, because we update this file, then we should update the metadata of foo. So we go back to the inode, foo's inode, then update, for example, last access time. So is that clear, Monkey?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I think this is a very good question because this is very fundamental. So after you understand this part, basically, you finish, concept-wise, you finish the homework and the project, right? Don't worry, okay? So please go to the homework too. Then the question two will help you to understand this this part. I think I answered our questions, right? So maybe other part, we have to update inode. Unit, right? So another issue is related to the unit. When we read, what is unit? Okay, remember, from our file system perspective, we always read the block. Okay, so because basically we divide our disk into logic blocks, right? Then of course, in terms of our hard disk or different storage media, that unit may be different, okay? So, but we have some device driver, we have some program to help us to translate this logic block number into the hardware unit. Okay, but here when we see read, then we always read the block. Okay. In our system call when we talk about here. But in your homework, to make it simple, we directly to let you to read the file. You can read the offset. You don't need to follow the block. Okay. So basically to help you to simplify the implementation, okay? It's not easier to update the inode first. I don't know this question, okay? Yeah, so maybe, do you want to clarify your question? Who's access time? Yeah, I think we should update this access time, right? Okay. I'm a little bit confused. Read is not byte by byte. So why are you confused? I already tell you, okay? Read is based on the block. You just read a block. Okay, that's it. Okay, don't be confused. So just read a block. So everything will be translated into the block. Then the low level program will translate this logic block number into the unit, the hardware device need. Okay, but from our perspective here is based on the block. Yeah. Okay, but of course, everything is decided by us. We talk about Linux system, basically. But in your homework, actually, you can read byte by byte. Okay, so so let me continue to finish this part, then I will go back to, let me summarize this part. Then maybe I will answer some questions. Yeah. So basically you can see here, read and write files are expensive in terms of IOs. Okay, particularly for write, we may involve a lot of IOs. Another issue is that if we have a very long path name, then when we read a file, because we need to go through all directory files, okay, one by one, then this is very painful. Okay, so to reduce this IO traffic, then file system aggressively use system memory to do the cache, to cache those directory entry. So in real implementation, actually, for directory entry, we will have some cache, okay, in to cache those directory most often used, those directory entry into, for example, you give me a directory file, then I will directly find the corresponding inode. Okay, basically we can have this kind of a, we call D entry, this kind of a cache. Then in this way, we don't need to go through this directory file, then find the corresponding mapping. We can directly go to this D entry mapping, find the corresponding inode from the particular directory file. Okay. So when we have this cache, basically we can have two different kind of mechanism to handle it. Either use a static way. For example, suppose we can use 10% of total memory as a cache, okay, for this kind of cache. This may not be very flexible. Okay. So sometimes we waste our space, sometimes maybe it's not good enough. Okay. So modern system use dynamic approach, which means, okay, our size will be adjusted based on the demand, okay, then we cache data, okay. If we, generally speaking, if we have a large cache, then we can reduce the read IO, okay. But write, it's not another story, because the write traffic, we have to go to the disk for persistence. Okay. So basically use cache, we cannot reduce write IO. Okay. But still we can use a write buffer for write system performance improvement. For example, we can delay writes. We can buffer a number of writes in memory. Okay. Then we can combine them together to do the IO. Okay, so we can avoid those, for example, we update to the same blocks, then basically we can combine them together, or we, so in this way, we can reduce write. Okay, some write can be finished inside our memory. Okay, then certainly we have issue here. So if a system crash, then maybe we have trouble, right? For example, this is a transaction related to you transfer $1 million to my account, but somehow we didn't do persistence. Then later system crashed, then we don't have this transaction. And then you say, oh, I already transferred $1 million to you, to your account, right? So we have this kind of trouble. Then to solve this, basically, we have some kind of called journaling to handle this, okay? But that's an advanced topic. I will not talk about this, but if you are interested, then you can go to the file system to see it. The idea is that we cache data. When we write, we cache data. However, we also write some small portion data into our log, okay? Then when system crash, then we can go to the log to find our data, okay? Another system call we already have, right? So I think basically, if we want to flush our data, then we can force to flush our data. Okay. So to summarize, for file system implementation, we talk about three key data structure: super block, inode, directory. Right? So this also relate to your project. Okay, and also relate to your paper-based homework assignment too, right? I know the directory, right? Then implementation, you have to go through the super block inode, then a directory, then finally you can find the file content, okay? So we also briefly talk about cache and buffer, but if you want to know more, then you should read the textbook and also some papers provided in the reference. The textbook. Okay. So basically I finished the file system implementation. So this is a big part. You can see that we have a project here. We have a paper-based assignment. And also we have some questions in the final exam you can expect, right? So make sure you fully understand this part. Then after you finish this part, then you should be very comfortable, okay, to get a good grade for this course. Okay, so let's have a break, 5 minutes break, then I will go back to answer some questions, then we go to finish, we go to the next topic, IO devices, okay. So 5 minutes break. Okay, I will, let me first pause the recording. Yeah, let me see some questions. I noticed there are some questions. Yeah, okay. Some question I think already answered. Then we have some new question here. So first, I think I noticed there is one question related to the INO number. Why start from 2? Actually, I don't know the answer. So I think maybe it's from some tradition. Okay, in the beginning, people will start from 2. Okay, but I have no idea why we start from 2. So maybe you guys Google it, okay, to help me answer that question. Okay. So unit is not user is can you guys see the whiteboard here? So I copy some question here. Okay, yeah. So so I think related to the read here, let me clarify this again. Okay, so when we talk about a file system, so usually we will talk about logic. When we read, we will read a logic block, okay, which is we have block number here. So here, when we read anything, we will issue the block number, then read that whole block. Okay, so based on, for example, 4 kilobytes, okay. Okay, then, however, this is decided by the system, okay? So basically, we may have different design. In your homework, in the project, you can directly read the file we provide byte by byte, okay? So the purpose here is to make it simple, okay? So I hope this is clear, okay? Yeah, come along. You have a question?
Yeah, sorry, may I ask here directly?
Yeah, sure.
When we're calling the read function, we usually specify how many bytes we want to read. So how does it work?
Yeah, so your question is how to, so in the read system call, right? In read system call, actually we will read, for example, file descriptor, then offset, starting offset and the count, right? How many, right? So is this a question you ask?
Yes.
Okay, so this is exactly the example that we provide, right? Basically from the offset, then from the count, then you should translate this into the block, right? Block number, right? how to do translation, go to the inode. Then inside the inode, we have mapping. Right?
But we, if we want to read 1 kilobyte only, but the block size is 4 kilobytes already, so how is it possible to read one kilobyte?
Yeah, that's a very good question. Okay, so if you want to read 1 kilobyte, then you still need to go to low level. So this is what I'm saying, that we have a low level inside our kernel, inside our file system. Then we will first read that block, whole block into the memory, then only return the 1 kilobyte you ask to the user. Because inside the kernel, we will handle this. Okay, so generally speaking, we have buffer inside the kernel, kernel buffer, to help us to hold this 4 kilobytes. Okay, then we return what you want, okay? So is this okay? Return 1 kilobytes, right? Huh? To you, is this okay?
So every time it always read in one block and then it just returned all the things we need inside that one particular block.
Yeah, it depends on your request, right?
Basically. So like when I called read function, when I called a read system call, let's say 1 byte, so it returned 1 byte, the first byte in that block, and then I call the read second time and it returned the second element in that block, right?
Yes.
So how about when it goes to the other block? Will it go back to the inode to find out the pointer, or you just directly go to the other block?
So if you want to read the other block, then you have to go to the inode to find the mapping. Then read the corresponding block from the disk into the memory. Yeah.
So it is handled by the kernel. So we for user level, we just call read continuously, right?
Yes. At user level, you prepare buffer. You just operate what you ask. But inside kernel, we will read this whole block and then return what you require. Yeah, I think, some student talk about this inode as well. So do we have any other questions related to this? Inode full, first or not byte by byte? Yeah, maybe this is related to your question. Yeah. So any other questions? This part. No question, okay. You guys ask some good question. Is data block a virtual concept instead of a real space in the disk? So it's not a virtual concept. So basically we call it a logic number, right? Logic space, logic. Yeah, so this is a concept. You can think about this as a kind of a logic space, logic, because we divide the whole disk. Yeah. But this will be mapped into a real space. So so from your description, I think it's okay. You can see it's a concept, yeah. But we will map this logic number into the disk, right? So go back to look at that example. Basically, after we have a disk, then we will divide this into data block, okay? Then each block number will be mapped to a real space on disk, okay? Okay, so let me go back to talk about, somehow, Yeah, maybe let me first discard this part. Open. Open IO devices. Okay, so let's go to the new topic, IO devices. I think here we also, some students also ask some questions related to IO devices. Okay, so first let's look at our organization. So basically we are still in persistence here, file and the file system implementation. So we finish file system implementation, particularly homework two and the project associated with this part. Then next topic, we'll talk about how to manage IO devices and storage. So I think some student asked some question related to this logic block, right? So then what is the real unit, then how to operate IO devices? So we will talk about this in this around like half an hour. Okay, so basically we need IO devices. The reason that we want to input our data, for example, use keyboard, we want to use a mouse to point to a particular location, right? So those are input devices. And also we need to display our data through the monitor, which is very important, okay? So this is output devices. Then this is very important. Okay, without IO devices, then we cannot input our data, we cannot display our data, then no one will use our computer system. Then we want to answer several issues here at a very high level. Okay, this is not a real, I mean, if you go to the real hardware device, then you know the detail, but here we only talk about some very high level concept. Then first issue is how should IO be integrated into the system? Okay. Second, what are general mechanisms? Okay. Third one, how to make them work efficiently. So basically we want to answer these three issues today. First, how to integrate those IO devices into the system, into computer system. So generally speaking, we use a bus. Okay, remember in the beginning, we talked about the Feynman architecture. We have, generally speaking, we have three components, CPU, memory, and IO. Then they connect through the bus. So CPU, memory, and IO devices, I connect through the bus, which means we will do communication through the bus. So particularly if we go to modern computer system, this is a general architecture. Of course, I mean, different computer system may have different bus architecture, but generally speaking, we usually have some high speed bus. Bus, you can think about it, is kind of like some real bus. You can send the information, right? Through this aware over there, then you can send the aware to another component. Okay? So we have some high speed bus, for example, showed in this figure. Here, CPU and memory, usually they connect through memory bus. Here we have very, very high speed compared to other devices because here memory are very important. Everything, if you want to process, no matter is instruction and the data, we need to go to our memory. So we have high speed memory bus here. Also, this is only used for CPU and memory. Okay, no others, no other data can utilize this bus. Okay. Then then even for our IO devices, we also have some high speed devices, for example, our graphic card, GPU, those kind of stuff, right? So when we play game, we want to have a very high performance graphic card so we can display our very interactive kind of interaction with those graphic effect. So those devices are connected through high-speed I/O bus. For example, PCIe, right now PCI Express, PCI Express, PCIe bus is widely used, okay? Here, we may connect our graphic card, our SSD through this bus, okay, right now. Then we go to some low speed bus, for example, our mouse, our USB, our hard disk, okay, traditional hard disk, okay, can connect to this slow bus, okay. Then basically, this is our system architecture. But generally speaking, we can use a bus to connect among CPU, memory, and I/O devices. Okay, so bus, what is a bus? Bus is data paths that are provided to do communication among three components, okay, CPU, memory, and I/O devices. Okay, then particularly we have I/O buses. I/O buses actually is a data path connect CPU to I/O devices, okay? Then we connect I/O devices to the I/O bus. Then this is three interface. We can have I/O ports, okay? Then from this I/O port, CPU can access. CPU can, later we'll talk about, basically this is the interface through those ports. This is kind of some numbers, okay? So each number is referred to a specific hardware place, we can think about, okay? A hardware a component, okay? Then use that one, the CPU can access this device, okay? Through this I/O ports. This is some address you can think of, okay? Then we also have some interface, okay, to do the communication. For example, we may need to transfer data between I/O devices and our CPU, right? So we need some interface here, some register, for example, okay? Then inside our device, maybe we need some controller and so on. So basically, generally speaking, you can think about like this way. You can treat this like this way. Okay, basically we have CPU, we have memory, we have I/O, then we have three component, then we have bus, then connect them together, okay? Then through this bus, we can do communication, that's it, okay? So from a very generic view to look at device, okay? Each device, canonical device, should have two components. You can see here, okay, hardware interface. I think this is what I mentioned here. We have device here, okay, interface. Then we have for each device, we have interface, and we also have the internal, we have device controller. This is the address CPU can access, okay? But from a device perspective, okay, we provide the interface. Then system software can utilize this hardware device to control the particular device, okay? Internally, this is related to the implementation. For example, this is a canonic device. So which means basically you can utilize this to represent any IO device. Then interface, usually we have status. For example, we can utilize this to represent what is this device busy? Or after we transfer data, does the transformation finish? So basically we can look at this status. Then we also have some interface related to the command. For example, say I want to send a command. Basically, I want to either read data from this device or I want to write data to this device. Okay, read and write. Right? So when we do read and write, the data will be put into this register. Okay, so basically this is the three register we have for a particular device. Then inside, this is related to the specific device. For example, if this is the SSD, then inside we have a controller to help us to look at the queue. So you send the request into the queue, then we will process the request and the data right into our flash chips, okay? Then if you have other devices, then maybe it's different. But generally speaking, we should have a microcontroller. Then we also have some memory, and we may have some specific chips for a specific function. For example, for SSD, when we store data, we need to have some flash chips, okay, to help us to store data. Okay. Then look at this hardware interface. Then basically we have status. This, from those status, we can check the current status of the device. Command register, then we want to do the read write basically. Okay, of course, we also have some, maybe we have some specific command for a particular device. Okay. Data, basically when we do read and write, then we can put data into this register. Okay. Then generally speaking, that's good enough for the interface. You can think about later, whenever you want to write a device driver, then think about it from this perspective. For all devices, you can look at three types of registers: status register, command register, data register. Then through this three type of register, then you can control a device. Typical interaction example is like this, okay? So first we look at whether or not this device is busy. Okay, then if we want to transfer data, we will write data to this device data register. Okay, then after we prepare data already, then we write the command to the command register, say, hey, please write the data into this device, because we already provide data, but it doesn't mean the data will be written into this device. So we have to send the command. Then we check the status, see whether or not this operation has been finished. For example, suppose this is a disk write. Then we first look at, is this hard disk is busy? So if this disk is ongoing for a write operation, then basically the status is busy. So we have to wait until this device is idle. Then we prepare our data. Then we say, we will write data to a particular location, blah, 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 blah. Okay, then say, write, start to write. Then at this moment, we will check the status because we already prepared data. We want to store our data onto a particular area on disk. Okay, then we check the status for the device. Check the status, see this write operation has been finished or not. So you finish that, okay, we are done. Okay. So when we check this status, basically we have two ways to do this. First way is a pooling, we call. Pooling is like this way. So in our software, we will do is this, we just check the status register for for this device repeatedly. You can see we have an infinite loop here. Basically, we just say, oh, is this a device ready? Okay. Oh, is this operation finished? Right? We just look at this. This is called pooling. Okay. So pooling, you can think about this is very simple. You can see the code is like, I only check the status. I read the status from that register, then I check the particular status. Okay, if it's not ready, then just continuously check this. Okay. However, because our program hung over there to wait until this status is ready, then basically we wait during this waiting time. Actually, from this figure, you can see that we waste our time, CPU time. For example, suppose we have task one here, then we want to write our data onto the disk. Remember, when we write the data, it takes around 10 milliseconds, okay, to write one sector data, one block data, okay, onto the disk. Okay, it's quite slow. Okay, then during this period, we just check whether or not this write has been finished. So we just use the program like this, this kind of program, and just wait, look at the status. Okay, then if we use we look at the time, a CPU executed at this moment, CPU. Because CPU run our task one, and task one start to wait, then to write to disk start to wait, then disk need some time to finish this operation. Okay, until finish, then the status will be changed. Then during this time period, our program will check the status then until this finish. Okay, so during this time period, this is pooling. This is a pooling. Pooling is like this, okay? Well, this status, you could be busy, then just can wait, okay? Check continuously to read the register value, okay? So we didn't do anything here, just wait for this operation to be finished by the disk, okay? So then obviously, maybe we should switch to another ready process in order to better utilize our CPU. Okay. So this go to another way to handle IO called interrupt. Okay. So the idea is very simple. Okay, so basically we can put the process associated with or involving with IO request to sleep. Okay. Then to switch to another process. Okay. Then after device operation, IO operation from this device has been finished, then we have interrupt. Okay, then wake up the process waiting for this IO by interrupt. See, basically a device say, okay, I will send an interrupt, say, oh, finish, this IO operation finished. Okay. So here, the good thing is that we allow CPU and disk processing concurrently. For example, you can see this example. Okay, first the CPU run task one here. Okay, then at a particular moment, CPU say, I want to issue our operations. Particularly, I want to write data to disk. Okay, I write data to disk. Then at this moment we switch, after we set up those registers, okay, we switch to task two. Okay, then disk will do IO operation for us because this is the right data, right? So if we already set up a data, if we already prepare data, if we already issue the command, then we can ask disk to do it, okay, concurrently. At the same time, we switch to task two, then switch task two can be executed concurrently with the disk at the same time, right? So basically we have better utilization for CPU and the disk. So which one is better? So it depends on the application, okay. If this device perform IO very quickly, then interrupt may slow down the system. The reason is that whenever we want to switch to another task, later we'll discuss, we need to remember a lot of states. For example, a lot of register we need to remember, then a lot of related process structure we need to remember. Then we have to set up all those information. Then we switch. Only when this IO operation takes a very long time, then we can get benefit. Otherwise, if this IO operation can be finished very fast, then this context switch overhead maybe is too much compared with this IO operation time. Then basically that may not be a good approach. So generally speaking, we will how to do this context switch is leave to the user program to decide. Either you can use pooling or interrupt to do it, okay? A general rule is that if the IO operation for this device is very fast, then pooling is best. Otherwise, interrupt is better. So we will go back to this interrupt later when we talk about the CPU. But the general idea is kind of simple, right? Basically, you can see here, we can do this kind of make a computation and IO operations in parallel. Yeah. So in reality, actually, not only this IO operation takes a very long time, and when we transfer data from our memory to the device, a large chunk of data. For example, I want to store a file. Okay, it involves a lot of data. Okay, so we have to move data from memory to the device, to our disk. Okay, so when we move data, look at this figure, it may take very long time. Okay, here actually is kind of a very mechanic. Okay, so basically we'll say, okay, from memory, this location, I want to transfer how much data, okay, then to a particular IO device, which location, right? So basically, I need to wait until this data transfer to the IO device. This usually is slow, okay? So of course, after we finish data transfer, then we can switch, but so can we do better for this part? So this is why usually in our computer system, we use a device hardware called directly memory access, DMA, to do this. This is the hardware to help us. Basically, whenever you want to transfer data between memory and IO, you can set up DMA. Say, okay, I want to transfer data from this location to another IO location, IO device. Okay, this is a starting address, this is a size, okay. Then you set up those information, you transfer those information into the DMA. Then directly memory transfer will say that this is a kind of hardware, say help us to transfer data from memory to disk or to other IO devices. Okay. Then CPU does not need to involve after we set up those, for example, starting address, ending address. That's it, okay? Which device, then CPU can happily schedule another task to run. Then DMA will help us to transfer data, okay? Then after we finish disk, we'll say, oh, I finished, okay? I issue an interrupt. Then basically we can switch back, okay, for the task map. Okay, so that's a real case usually in modern computer system when we do this kind of IO operation. Okay, so basically, this is the first part, how to control the IO device, different mechanism. The another issue is how to access those IO device. We have two ways. The first way is use the x86, for example, Intel processor. We use a separate IO instruction, okay? So, in this way, actually, we have special instruction. Later, I will show you, okay, some special instruction in and out. So this is particularly designed for IO device. Then use this special instruction, then we can access IO. Then remember, I talk about the ports. So we have different IO address, which is a port number. Then based on this in and out, in is we want to read from a particular IO device. Out means we want to write to a particular IO device. Then each IO device is a port number. Then use this port number, then with a different data we write to different port, then basically we can interact with those IO devices. Another way is use a memory mapped IO. Okay. Memory mapped IO means, okay, I don't have a specific IO instruction. Okay. So we will use the load store. So remember our fundamental instruction is load store. Our whole computer for Neumann architecture, most important part is based on this load store model. Basically, we will go to the memory, use load store, then you give me address, I find the data, then load into register, then basically process those data, then write, then store back, okay? Load store, okay? So here, when we handle our IO, actually we also use load store. There's no specific IO instruction. So basically we will access those address as we access those regular memory address. However, we have some special location. This memory location is related to IO devices. Then through those memory address, then we can interact with our IO devices, okay? So which one is better? Yeah, so it depends, okay? If you see from hardware perspective, if we use this IO instruction, then we have to have a special hardware to handle it. For example, we need to have some IO bus to help us to handle those instruction. We need to have a separate decoder for those, because we have a special instruction here, so we have to handle those instructions. So hardware become complicated, okay? Then here, if we use memory map IO like ARM, our smartphone based on ARM processor. So memory map IO is much more simpler in terms of hardware design, right? Because basically we will utilize the same memory controller to handle all those memory operations. However, if this part of memory address are specially allocated for IO device, then we go to the IO device. Okay, that's it. Okay. So certainly from hardware perspective, okay, this IO instruction, Intel processor is more complicated. Okay. However, in terms of performance, of course, because we have some special hardware to handle IO instruction, then it's more efficient, right? Okay. See that in terms of design, of course, okay, so ARM-based processor is simpler because this here, we don't need those special hardware, then our design can be simpler, okay? Yeah. In terms of performance, of course, maybe IO instruction is better. But right now, this memory mapped IO is widely used, okay? Even for the Intel processor, nowadays, they also use this memory mapped IO, okay? Okay, then from software perspective, actually here, we just talk about some hardware, then how to. So to summarize, actually, we discussed the interface, right? So basically, this is the interface. We use the software to interact with our IO device. Then we talk about the way to interact with mechanism to interact with the IO device. Either we go to pooling or we go to the interrupt. Then we talk about how to access particular IO device, either use IO instruction or use the memory mapped IO. Then we can find the corresponding IO devices. Okay. Then from an operating system perspective, how to design, how to interact with the device. Okay. So here is our general interface. Remember, in the beginning, we talked about all devices will be treated as a file, okay? So we will interact with all devices through file interface. Basically, we already know the interface. From the user perspective, it's open, read, write, close. Then we may have other, for example, we may have IO control, okay? Input, output, control, those kind of system call, okay, to help us to pass some special command to the IO device. But generally speaking, this interface is similar. It's the same, it's not similar, it's the same as the regular file operation. Okay? So this is from application perspective. So from file system perspective, actually, we will provide a generic interface. Either this is for a block device or this is for capture device, we call it. Okay. But generally speaking, we will have a generic, which means inside our file system, we already have some function. We already have some prototype we design for each device. You have to follow this. When you design a device driver, okay, here, you have to follow the interface designed by our file system, okay? Particularly, we have several layers. From the file system layer, we have some function already designed, kernel function. You have to follow it to in order to implement the function, okay? Then go to the device driver layer, we also have some protocol you have to follow, okay? Interface, okay? Then finally, follow that, you can develop your device driver for a particular device, okay? Basically, this part actually is over 70% of operation code is related to the device driver, okay? Then it causes a lot of bugs because this is provided by the manufacturer. Usually, so the quality is not very good. Okay, but anyway, okay. So next, I'm going to talk about some use a simple IDE describer to give you kind of to help you to look at what is a device driver, block device driver particularly. Okay. So, but basically, we will not go to the detail. So if you want to know this, you have to design a real device driver. So from that part, I recommend you to read this book if you are interested to design some device driver. As I mentioned, Linux provides a generic interface. Then you just follow it. You can design a device driver. This is a classical book, Linux device driver. Right now it's third edition, no fourth edition. Okay, this is a free book, open source book. Then you can see here, it'll go to a lot of different kinds of device. After introduce device driver, modular, then go to the capture device, block device, then also talk about how to handle a memory and so on inside the kernel. Then go to specific, how to handle interrupt, then go to specific PCI device, USB device, and so on, okay? Then go to network driver, TTY driver, and so on. So this is a very good book for device driver development, okay? So if you are interested, then you should go here. And also this is the first step to know kernel, because device driver is inside the kernel, then you have to use a lot of kernel function. Yeah, when you design device driver, you have to understand the kernel mechanism. Okay, I guess that's all for today's lecture. Okay, so any questions? So next, tomorrow I will finish IDE device driver. Yeah, basically, okay. Yeah, I will talk about this Linux device driver again, maybe this. Okay, so that's all for today's lecture. Yeah, I'm ready to answer some question. So please post your question through the chat box. If you don't have any question, then maybe you can leave now, okay? Yeah. So let me copy some questions. You guys can continuously input your questions through the chat box. Yeah, so I think I answered this question. Let me emphasize this again. I think this is also a very good question, a typical question. Is the data block a virtual concept instead of a real space in disk? So as I mentioned, okay, file system, in file system, right, we will divide our disk space into fixed size unit. Yeah. Then, and each one, we call it a block, right? For example, 4 kilobyte unit, okay? So it's not kind of a virtual concept. Actually, we call it a logic block number, right? Then this logic block number will be translate into real disk space somewhere, right? So for example, in our example, we divide our whole disk into 64 blocks, But in reality, maybe we have more blocks. But basically, with each block number, then we can find the corresponding area onto our disk. But is that possible that one data block map to different disk session? For one device, one file, right? Then basically this is impossible. You cannot map one block into a different disk session. No, we cannot. So this must be the fix, right? So a device is a file. Yeah, device is treated a file. Device is treated as a file. Yeah, so you are right. Okay, a device is a file. Yeah, from a Linux and Unix perspective. Could you please explain slides 16? Okay, cannot follow tomorrow. Yeah, so I will go back to the slide 16. So this question maybe is related to the video lecture. Actually, I have released a video lecture since we start online teaching. So every day after our lecture, I will release the video lecture, okay? So don't worry, okay? So I will release the video lecture, right? Okay, slide 16. Okay, let me go back. Slide 16. Okay. Oh, this one? This one, right? Is this the slides you talk about? Hello? Yeah, who asked the question?
Yes, this one, please.
Oh, this one, okay. So, generally speaking is that, inside our operating system, when we manage our device, actually we will follow some convention. So we already designed some interface. Then when you develop a device driver, you have to follow those interface. So basically we have some function prototype already defined. Then you just implement your function. That's it. Okay, so then we have several layers. You can see that inside the file system, we have some prototype. Then inside our block layer, generic block device driver layer, then we have some interface. Then inside the device layer, then this layer is designed to work with specific hardware. Then we have some prototype. Then you need to follow those convention, follow those prototype to design, to develop the device driver. Okay, so I know this is a very abstract. Okay, then this is why I suggest you to go to that Linux device driver, because that deserves a whole book to talk about, right? So after you design a device driver, then you understand what I'm talking about. But generally speaking, you can think about we have some generic interface. You already have some prototype. That you have to follow that in order to design a device driver. Okay. I hope I answer your question. Yeah, why we need those convention? Okay, that's a very good question. Okay, so see, if we don't have this convention, then everyone can design their own device driver. Then we will have a lot of trouble to manage those code. Right, After we have this interface, then basically we'll say, okay, you have to implement device driver follow this convention. Then we will put your device driver into the Linux kernel. Otherwise, we will not make your code committed. Basically, if you don't follow, then your code cannot be included into the Linux kernel, right? Then if everyone follows the convention, it's also good for us to understand the code. Otherwise, if you don't follow this, then no one understand your implementation, right? So basically, we want to have some constraint, okay, to give you a generic interface. Then we, so everyone need to follow this. Then it's easy for us to understand your code. Then also it's easy to manage those code. Yeah, I hope I answer your question. Of course, there are many reasons, but mainly, I think it's because of this. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay, so looks like no questions. Then I will see you tomorrow. Okay, thank you guys. Bye bye.